Good news, everyone! People care about the Supreme Court again. Bad news? The reason why. Now, this is a bit of a tricky episode for me because as a guy who studied economics, well, I'm generally not the moral authority of my friend group. I had a little bit of trouble covering this one because first, how can you add anything to a conversation that's been going on 24 hours a day for weeks? I mean, I could tell you more about Brett Kavanaugh's high school experience than I could about my parents. And I haven't done any research yet. Secondly, this whole thing is based less on fact and more on he said, they said situations, where, while witnesses are credible, definitive answers just aren't there. Three accusers have come out so far, although Brett Kavanaugh has said that they're all lying. I know, breaking news, right? As a quick opener, I know this whole thing is drenched in partisan stink, but I view this as less partisan than some. Because, well...
On this vote, the ayes are 54, the nays are 45. The nomination of Neil M. Gorsuch of Colorado to be an Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States is confirmed.
Yeah, if you don't nominate scummy people, you get results. Don't get me wrong, people were mad at Gorsuch. I mean, some people think he stole a Supreme Court justice seat from a more liberal justice, which was the biggest problem in his confirmation hearing. But none of this other crap. I mean, look at this senator.
After President Trump nominated a mainstream nominee, Democrats then looked for other ways to make him out to be some sort of extremist or radical. But they failed because there's simply no evidence to justify those kinds of characterizations.
Yeah, nobody could find any evidence of wrongdoing because he was a good candidate, of which you have quite the list of good choices instead of the douchebag alter ego of Stephen Janowski.
I will not miss a party. I brought eggs.
You won't be able to unsee that. And you could make a credible argument that Republicans just didn't know how shady Kavanaugh was when they nominated him.
Did you meet with Senator Dianne Feinstein on August 20th?
I did meet with Senator Feinstein.
Did you know that her staff had already recommended a lawyer to Dr. Ford?
I did not know that.
Did you know that her and her staff had this allegations for over 20 days?
I did not know that at the time.
If you wanted an FBI investigation, you could have come to us. What you want to do is destroy this guy's life, hold this seat open, and hope you win in 2020. You've said that.
Yeah, kind of feels like maybe Democrats had all the information and held back on it until Republicans were pushed into a corner backing him. And if that sounds like a good idea, just ask President Trump. Hey, Obama, I'd hate to have known about all those Russia connections the FBI dug up long before the primaries. To be fair to Democrats, though, according to USA Today, the official newspaper of what? You don't carry the New York Times? On July 9th, President Donald Trump announced his nomination of Kavanaugh to the High Court to replace retiring Justice Anthony Kennedy. And we only found out about the accusations on July 30th when it was sent to the top Democrat on the Senate Judiciary Committee, Dianne Feinstein. And don't worry, then we got right into action releasing those documents to the proper parties so that party members could respond. Because a month and a half later, on September 12th, we sent it to the FBI, which was a week after Kavanaugh's confirmation hearings ended on the 7th, with no mention of Ford. Now this, of course, forced another round of high-profile confirmation debates and led to the Republicans looking super scummy in the court of public opinion. Now, before I get into the main story of what is currently going on, I feel like I need to just take a second to look at the big picture here, because the bar is super low right now. I feel like if we can reasonably say that this Supreme Court nominee didn't try to rape someone in high school, we'll let him in. I mean, maybe I should polish off my resume. In focusing on this, though, we've stopped mentioning the other truly unprecedented aspects.
First, of course, the big explosion down on Capitol Hill. Judge Brett Kavanaugh's Supreme Court nomination hearing kicked off this morning with just a whole lot of chaos. Democrats delayed the start of the hearing by 77 minutes as they objected to what they called missing documents related to Kavanaugh's service under President George W. Bush.
Nope, not what they call missing documents, just missing documents. Now these 100,000 pages weren't misplaced. Donald Trump decided to use executive privilege to keep them hidden. And we'll just put it this way. I'm guessing that these blocked documents don't go over charity work and a MacArthur Genius Grant. To clarify, the use of executive privilege to block this is not illegal by any means. In fact, it's one of the most constitutional things a president can do. It's just, what's the word?
A lawyer for President Bush released over 40,000 pages of documents on Kavanaugh. President Trump has also claimed executive privilege blocking more pages from being released. Democrats are arguing they still don't have enough of the documents they would like to see pertaining to Kavanaugh's record. Is all of this typical for Supreme Court confirmation proceedings?
No, nothing is typical anymore. I don't think anything's been typical for a number of years in American political life.
Unprecedented, that's it. Man, do I hate that word now. These documents would have gone over things like,
did Brett Kavanaugh give President Bush advice on whether or not he had to follow Congress's ban on torture? Did Brett Kavanaugh give President Bush advice on whether or not he should sign a federal ban on an abortion procedure? Whether or not Congress should give federal immunity from lawsuits to the gun industry? All of these important issues and Brett Kavanaugh's advice are being shielded from the public, and we need to know why.
Now, I again can't tell you what's actually on these documents, but I can tell you that they're intentionally being hidden from us, and let your imagination do the grunt work. Other things are just generally like lying under oath, a crime I've sadly started to take for granted these days. We're not talking huge things, well, maybe we are, but the executive privilege protects many documents that will make that impossible to prove. But there are provable lies on different scales, with Dick Durbin saying,
"You said to me unambiguously, under oath, the following. I was not involved and am not involved in the questions about the rules governing detention of combatants. But later, just a week or so ago, you acknowledged in my office that you were involved."
Yeah, but he was a young man back in 2006. We can't judge his fitness for Supreme Court based on that. But for the most part, we're talking about things like,
okay, drinking is one thing, but the concern is about truthfulness. And in your written testimony, you said sometimes you had too many drinks. Was there ever a time when you drank so much that you couldn't remember what happened or part of what happened the night before?
No, I remember what happened, and I think you've probably had beers, Senator, and so...
You're saying there's never been a case where you drank so much that you didn't remember what happened the night before or part of what happened?
You're asking about, blackout. I don't know. Have you?
Could you answer the question, Judge? That's not happened. Is that your answer?
Yeah, and I'm curious if you have.
Man, I would love to do that in a job interview. Let me see your references first. But yeah, that was him swearing under oath he'd never gotten blackout drunk. Or the Chicago Tribune reporting Kavanaugh was under oath when he swore the friendly innocence of the Renee statements and several other highly implausible interpretations of yearbook slang that seemed to relate to binge drinking and sex. Unfortunately, there is no exception in perjury law for the really stupid lies. Now, because we live in a post-fact society, I did have to Google, is lying to a Senate Judiciary Committee normal? And I can tell you that some people raised the stink during Kagan's confirmation hearings, but the alleged lie was incredibly nuanced and hard to pin down, as opposed to I've never been blackout drunk. Which, what a stupid thing to lie about considering the overwhelming evidence. Lastly, there's that phantom debt that has gone unexplained. Back during the time when it was still a funny thing to make fun of this candidate, instead of it just being sad.
Enter Rhode Island Democratic Senator and man who will never live in his last name, Sheldon Whitehouse, who asked Kavanaugh, have you ever sought treatment for a gambling addiction, and specifically whether Kavanaugh gambled on any game of chance or skill with monetary stakes, including but not limited to poker, dice, golf, sports betting, blackjack, and craps.
Okay, well that's specific. This was called into question because he had about $200,000 in debt that just disappeared in 2017, with no form showing that he had repaid it. He explained away the debt in the most suspicious description I've heard. He bought baseball tickets. Now that might sound like an awful way of spending money, but hey, I'm not on a court, so it's not my place to judge. It only gets suspicious for me when Kavanaugh explains he split up those tickets with old friends whom he still declines to name through a ticket draft held at his house. I mean, come on, at least go through the effort of getting your friends to lie for you. Sure, most people will probably think they're lying, but just put some effort into your excuse. Anyways, his disappearing debt has sparked some concern over a conflict of interest, because, well, nobody knows for sure what happened there. Although some are accepting his explanation. Basically, even if nothing comes of this sexual assault allegation, there are provable offenses out there that are still pretty... Alright, so now that we've gotten that out of the way, let's talk about the story everyone is talking about. But with a twist. So, if you were watching the meeting that led up to a week-long extension to the investigation, you'd know that something really weird happened.
I make a request to the White House to ask the FBI to do that investigation. It would be short and limited in scope to the current allegations that have been made.
Mr. Chairman.
Because of the two-hour rule, we're adjourned.
What?
The two-hour rule.
No vote.
When did we come in? Did we come in at noon? No. Yeah, we did. Yeah, the two-hour rule.
We came in at noon?
Yeah, we knew you were going. We had to get this all done by 2 o'clock.
Well, is it done? Is Flake's is it going to happen? Or did you cut off a vote?
No, we didn't have a motion in front of us. This is all a gentleman and women's agreement.
Now I was watching that and was apparently about as confused as Dianne Feinstein was. Seriously, what was that? Well, sounds like we have a gentleman's and ladies agreement. I wonder if that's going to hold up in court. Anyways, turns out that yesterday, Trump said, "I've ordered the FBI to conduct a supplemental investigation to update Justice Kavanaugh's file. As the Senate has requested, this update must be limited in scope and completed in less than 1 week." So, less than 1 week. That could either mean a week, or that could mean, and hopefully for my sake not, that this investigation will be over before I manage to get this video out. My question is, what does an FBI investigation even look like? I mean, there are some huge challenges for investigators, including some of the most key and basic details you would want to know. The three details that this investigation is expected to address. First, whether this party happened. Well, that sounds important. Ford listed out four people she remembers from the party. Brett Kavanaugh, Mark Judge, a boy named PJ, and her friend Leland. Okay, investigators can work with that. Only problem, they're all saying...
I don't recall it.
Mark Judge said he had no memory of this alleged incident. Her friend Leland Keeser said through her lawyer that she does not know Judge Kavanaugh and has no recollection of being at a party with him, although she later said she trusts Ford more than her memory. And then you have PJ, who sounds like the fun one in the group. Come on, his name is two letters. Well, PJ said he had no knowledge of the party in question. And that leaves Brett Kavanaugh as a witness, and we all know where he stands. So what do you do with this? The thing most people speculate will happen is first an FBI interrogation of Mark Judge, who was allegedly in the room when everything went down. Now, people think that he legitimately does not recall the event at all because he drank enough to fill a lake that summer. So he doesn't remember much of anything. So questions would be more like, did you ever drink to the point of blackout? To the point of vomiting? Did Kavanaugh? And people are already saying that this question alone could lead to a perjury charge. Because, remember...
Was there ever a time when you drank so much that you couldn't remember what happened or part of what happened the night before?
No,
you're saying there's never been a case where you drank so much that you didn't remember what happened the night before or part of what happened?
Yeah, no.
Or questions like, is Brett Kavanaugh any part of the inspiration for Bart O. Kavanaugh, a character in your book who vomited in somebody's car and passed out after a party? Well, I can't see that being true. I mean, he changed the whole two letters in the name. Just general questions like that to see how plausible Ford's accusations are. Luckily, prosecutors got a break on the when it happened question, because Kavanaugh turned over his personal calendar from that year, and they've identified one suspicious date. On July 1st, a Thursday, he noted plans to go to Timmy's for skis, slang for drinking beer, with three people Dr. Blasey said were at the gathering when she said the alleged assault occurred. first. What a nerd. I mean, seriously? Oh, let's make plans to drink. Let me just get on my Trapper Keeper so I can document it all. You know what'll make me seem hip? If I call it skis instead of beers in case someone else eventually reads this. Think of how cool I'll look. Anyways, the goal here would be to narrow down the time frame and see if the witnesses who say they don't have any recollection of this party happening can say that they definitively don't remember this party or just that this party didn't happen because, well, they didn't know a sexual assault may have happened upstairs and only a few people were there. So yeah, it would probably be a pretty boring and unmemorable party. Sounds like a check your watch and pretend to text someone in the corner type of party. Lastly,
in your text to the Washington Post dated 7/6, so that's the very first statement we have from you, you put in there, quote, have therapy records talking about it.
Ford had talked about the event a few times before Kavanaugh became a Supreme Court nominee. Specifically that therapy sessions, three of her friends and her husband. Here they're looking for some electronic records of communication, the circumstances these claims were made, if there are any inconsistencies in the stories, just kind of trying to see what they can learn. That's going to be what this investigation really is, which means that we probably won't get a yes or no answer to this question, but rather a general feeling of what was going on. Something that I think most people entering this case already knew. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking right here, or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking that subscribe button below. Let freedom ring by clicking that bell, and remember to give me a thumbs up. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.